Now, I have the privilege of presenting a general overview of what I hope will be achieved, and perhaps with a little bit of background as well. And since I have an enormous amount of material to cover in a very short time, I will use a lot of pictures. And I urge you, therefore, to fasten your seatbelts and get ready for a roller coaster ride. I will cover a lot of topics, as you can see, and in dealing with this, which is the basis, I think, why we believe that investments in education, science, and culture are not only helpful to advance our own cause of development in our countries, but will also help the cause of global understanding and better bridges between the United States and the countries of Muslim majorities and Muslim communities everywhere. So, as I cover all of this, you will see each of these headings appear in a red slide like that, which is like a new chapter heading, and therefore you know that I'm getting closer to the end, so don't worry. Let me proceed with a prologue that, for many of us who have lived the nightmare of the Cold War, we were happy to see pushing back the specter of nuclear holocaust, but I think that many quickly discovered that security was not necessarily obtained. And in fact, on 9/11 was a very important event because it was an attack on the soil of the United States itself, in the heart of New York. It brought about a quick transformation of attitudes in the US, and we know what followed in terms of destructive wars that have taken place. Wars are always destructive, and understanding is usually impaired during wars. And as has been stated by a number of our colleagues who spoke before, the issue of Palestine, for many of us, remains at the heart of any real advances. And yet, we have seen violence prevail. And for me, as a librarian, of course, that's a very particular picture, which I think is very powerful, whether it's books or bombs. But I will call a witness that I think everybody will recognize. Napoleon Bonaparte, who probably used the sword more than anybody, while at the same time did a lot in founding the Civil Code and other things, reflecting at the end of his life in St. Helena, here is what Napoleon Bonaparte had to say. Do you know what astonished me most in the world? The inability of force to create anything. In the long run, the sword is always beaten by the mind. Now, coming from Napoleon, I think it's something worthy for all of those who use force to reflect on. For all of us, of course, in everything we do in our own societies, in the pursuit of security and stability, we seek peace and justice. And obvious reminders need to be restated. There shall be no security without peace. There shall be no peace without justice. There shall be no justice without equity, and no equity without inclusion. And as we all know, after a rather difficult period in relations between the United States and our part of the world, President Obama not only issued a number of declarations, he actually came and spoke here in Egypt and promised a new beginning, to which, as you heard from some of my colleagues, we have added a question mark. He delivered a masterful speech, but is it enough, people will ask. I think the answer is not yet, of course. We want some action on a number of important political fronts. But beyond the wars and the political problems that still divide us, can we find new initiatives in things that do unite us? And that is the purpose of this conference. Set aside for the moment some of these issues and see whether we can build better collaborations in education, science, and culture. Now, we've heard several mentions about clash of civilizations, dialogue, and alliance of civilizations. Actually, since the collapse of the Cold War and the appearance that things would be going America's way, things have changed. From the chutzpah of my friend Frank Fukuyama declaring the end of history, and to the late Sam Huntington's The Clash of Civilizations. Notice that the subtitle of The Clash of Civilizations is the remaking of world order. So it was a proposal as much as a thesis. And this is a summary of the presentation of that, what was basically an important paper then turned into a book, and in which he highlighted that the so-called Western Islamic confrontation would be there on a civilizational basis. The response to that came from President Khatami of Iran, then President of Iran, who at the United Nations called for a dialogue of civilizations, not a clash of civilizations. And sure enough, the United Nations adopted the views that were presented, and they produced, by a distinguished panel of wise people, this report, Crossing the Divide, Dialogue Among Civilizations. But some of us felt that this was not enough, and that we had to go further, and to move from dialogue of civilization to the alliance of civilizations. And I had the privilege of serving on that committee. Here I am with Prime Minister Erdogan and Prime Minister Zapatero and Kofi Annan, when we presented a report on the alliance of civilizations to execute projects together. What projects can we do to deal with media, with youth, with immigration, with real issues, with education, with stereotypes, with human rights, with the rights of women, with other issues? Where can we actually collaborate to advance this? We had an important setback at the time of the Khartoum controversy, but the Alliance of Civilizations report worked hard and avoided a similar outbreak later on under the leadership of President Sampaio of Portugal, who is now the High Commissioner on Alliance of Civilizations for the United Nations. We were able to avoid similar outbreaks despite the continuation of some European politicians to disparage Islam in terrible ways. So what we want, really, is perhaps best captured in the writing of a sentence written by a writer who had a foot in each camp. Nobel winner Albert Camus, partly Algerian, partly French. He summarized it by saying, "Don't walk behind me, I may not lead. Don't walk in front of me, I may not follow. Just walk beside me and be my friend." This is the foundation of mutual respect. This is the foundation of new relationships where we can, in fact, be next to each other and dialogue. And already the younger generation is doing this on a scale that is unprecedented in human history. 450 million people are on Facebook. They create virtual communities. They link up with each other around the world, and who knows where these kinds of dialogues will lead. But what is important, as has been said by so many, is to get beyond the stereotypes. How do you read another person's culture? And here I think a profound observation by the great writer Marcel Proust, that the real voyage of discovery consists not in seeking new lands, but in seeing with new eyes. So frequently the reality is in front of us, but we see it in a slanted way or through particular lenses. We need to change our perspective in order to move forward. Let's look at the culture of the Muslim peoples everywhere in the world. It's a culture that has produced masterpieces that the whole world is proud of. Look at the Taj Mahal in non-predominantly Muslim India. Look at the Alhambra in the eminently Christian Spain. In all of these, the contribution of Islam has been profound, and the Muslim peoples have been profound. We have produced some of the most beautiful manuscripts and representations. We've produced calligraphy, and superficial readings of the other can be misleading, and they have been promoted, as was said by my friend from ISESCO, by Orientalists who wanted to emphasize the exotic other. So as a result of that, we have a whole series of false dichotomies that we have to set aside. Modernity and tradition, high tech and low tech, Muslim and non-Muslim contributions to a culture, and so many more. Let's look quickly at these false dichotomies. I will use images because they will speak more loudly than descriptions. We think that the West and Western cities are modernity, and the East, this particular city, that was New York, and this is Bukhara, that is tradition. I show you this beautiful manuscript. This is 10th century Kufic writing. And I show you this piece of art by Palestinian artist Kamal Boulata in 1983, clearly inspired by the same work. But modern, you can emphasize, this is not an old manuscript, this is a modern one. And then I show you something like this, which looks very modern, maybe inspired by a computer chip, or maybe inspired by the work of Piet Mondrian, a great modernist artist. But actually, if you look a little bit more carefully, you will see this is the word Ali, flipped over four times. And this is a piece from the Topkapi Museum done in the 16th century. Somebody, in an unselfconscious way, produced this eminently modern design at a time. He wasn't bothered with struggling between tradition and modernity, just expressing themselves. Take a question like the veil. Well, some women do not wear the veil, other women do wear the veil. Both coexist in Egypt, everywhere. And the question for us is, what does it mean? It's not a matter of education. You can see very advanced persons, like in this particular photograph, or here, among the readers of the Library of Alexandria. It is therefore something societal, something more profound. Simplistic arguments as to what it is should not be adopted, but should call for greater caution in understanding what is intended. Look at the notion of high-tech and low-tech. Beautiful example from Mali. This is the great mosque of Nyono. Beautiful architecture, yes, but also low-tech. This is, of course, Frank Gehry's museum in Bilbao, high-tech. After all, my friends in the West say, we invented the word modernity. This is the Frank Lloyd Wright Museum of Modern Art in New York, the Guggenheim Museum of Modern Art. And I say to them, yeah, but so is this. This is also the Menara Menasinghi in Malaysia, and so is this. And this in the Gulf, I don't have to tell you how many modern parts now exist, all of which are part of the Muslim culture today. But how about the Islamicity of something? I show you this gentleman, who is not a sultan. This is Rabbi Abraham ben Azra, who was the head of the Jewish community in Cairo in the late 17th century. And his dress and his appearance is very much that of the common society of the time. A more recent example, from the memoirs of Ahmad Shafiq Basha in 1931, this picture between a sheikh and a priest. And you can hardly tell them apart. Well, what could be more Islamic than the decoration of a Quran? And there's a beautiful example here from Dar al-Kutub, and I show you, from the same period, a Bible, same decoration. Aha! How about Arabesque designs? We know that because Muslim civilization frowned upon representations of human bodies and plants, we developed this very sophisticated Arabesque design. True enough, this is the minbar, or the pulpit, of the Muayyad Mosque in Cairo. But here is exactly the same design used in the Gamaliel Church of the same period, a stone throw away from the one I showed you. So, how about the veil? Surely, that is strictly Islamic. To which I show you that, yes, it is true in many societies, it is Islamic, but I show you this picture. And this is 1923, the Coptic Patriarchate in Cairo. These are Christian ladies. It was just common social practice at the time, until a Muslim lady, Huda Sha'arawi, actually led a demonstration in 1924 in which she removed the veil. She removed the veil in 1924 and led the campaign for that in the past, a campaign which incidentally is immortalized in the statue by Muslim Mahmoud Mukhtar, the great sculptor of Egypt in the 1930s, who impressed with her work, said, "This is Egypt rising, the Renaissance of Egypt." The fellaha with her hand on a rising sphinx on one side, but on the other side, like Huda Shahrawi, removing her veil. So maybe Christian, Muslim, Egyptian, Iranian, Turkish, whatever, these are societal choices that are different. Look at this. This is the Coptic Museum in Cairo. And you can see here the cross in the front of the facade. Where did they go for inspiration to build the Coptic Museum in Cairo? To the Al-Aqmar Mosque of the Fatimid Cairo from the 11th century. So all in all, what we have are societies that have intermingled in the spirit of tolerance, where each created and brought their own contribution to create a rich mosaic of living culture and cultural exchange. So please, let's avoid stereotypes and oversimplification. And that also applies to us, Arabs and Muslims, who must improve our understanding of the United States with its complexities and its pluralism. Now, why is all this important? Because we need to go back to the issue of values and how it governs social actions. Now, we talk of the knowledge-based society, but knowledge is much more than information. Data, when organized, becomes information. Information, when interpreted, becomes knowledge. But frankly, we need more than knowledge. We need wisdom. And wisdom is not just about knowledge, it is combining knowledge with values to know how to design a course of action in this world vis-a-vis ourselves and others. And that is something which we need to advance. And values are very much driven by belief systems, are driven by cultural frameworks within which we all work. But we can, I think, as has been said also, agree on a core of universal values. Honor, courage, compassion, common sense, dignity, loyalty, respect, fairness. Who could disagree? We could add love of nature. We could add appreciation of the arts. Who could disagree to all of these? So, such values, if emphasized, will give purpose to social action nationally and internationally. And different societies use values to make social choices whose criteria can vary over different situations and different times. So if you want to understand each other, you must avoid projecting our own implicit set of values and social criteria before we judge what they're doing. So understanding each other's values helps us understand each other's choices. Let's stop for a brief parable. On the way home, you meet the children, three children with a flute. And they ask you, "We need you to help us decide who should get the flute." And so the first child says, "Look, these two kids are very wealthy. They have all sorts of toys. I have nothing. I'm very poor. And that would be the only toy that I can have. And therefore, I should get it." And the other two children do not contest these facts. So rightly you would say, "Well, give it to this poor kid." Okay. Rewind, go back again, same story, same three children, and with the flute. And the girl says, "What do you mean, give it to him? I am the only one who knows how to play the flute. I'm a musician. I love to play the flute. These other boys, they enjoy listening to me play the flute. And they don't know how to play the flute. They just blow on it like a whistle. And therefore, I should play it. I enjoy it. They can enjoy listening to me." And the others do not contest that. Again, in this case, you would say, "Well, she should get it, and everybody will be happy listening to beautiful music." Now, rewind again, and you get the third child. And the third child says, "He may be poor, and she may be a musician, but I made the flute. I took a piece of wood, and I put the holes in it, and I made the flute. So what do you mean, give it to them? He may be poor, she may be a musician, but I made it. It's mine." And again, they don't contest the facts, and he would say that he's entitled to it. Now, what this little story tells us, if I were to transfer it to the jargon of social choice theory, is that in one case you're choosing equity as a criterion, in another one you're choosing utility, in the third one you're working with entitlement. There is no right answer. There really isn't. It is not like a mathematical problem that can be resolved. At different points in society, society as a whole will agree to give greater weight to equity or to utility or to entitlement as things may be, to maintain social cohesion, to advance progress, and to other objectives as well. It is useful to understand that and to try to understand the underlying motivations that design the appropriate actions on criteria of social choice. And very frequently, we misunderstand each other because we don't dig deep enough in trying to understand the cultural values of societies. But whatever the cultural choices of society, in no case can majority choice be allowed to infringe on the human rights of the minority. For whatever system we set up, it is as much about protecting the rights of minorities as it is about ensuring the views of majority are heard. And so we come back to the question of the West and the Muslims. And like my friend Ahmed Darwish, I agree that we need to rethink this question. America is the uncontested leader of what is generally referred to politically as the West. And yes, there is a widespread view today that has been advanced by the stories I mentioned before about the confrontation with Muslims. But frequently, this is how the Muslim world is presented in maps. I don't think that's very accurate. I prefer this map. Now, what's interesting about this map is that it shows, in fact, that some countries in Europe have percentage-wise as many Muslims as India or some other countries in the Muslim world. And I have told my friends in Europe that, you know, you can't talk about us and the Muslims. The Muslims are here. They are in your own countries. They are your own citizens. They are the children of immigrants. You have to recognize the fact that Islam is part of the West today. It is no longer a force that is outside of it, that somehow keep them there, and we are here. Who's we? Are you going to mistreat a significant minority of your own citizens, born and bred in your own countries? This is a serious question that requires rethinking. And at the same time, important as Islam is to Muslims, it is not the only dimension by which we define our identities. Look at Central Asia, which has recently, of course, been liberated from the yoke of communism, but there's an enormous complexity of ethnicities, cultures, subcultures, languages that are important in defining alliances and allegiances. The same is true of Afghanistan and the countries around it. But I tell my friends in Europe and the West more generally that we have lived under Western occupation and we have lived in a Eurocentric world. History, geography, and perceptions of modernity were defined from a Eurocentric perspective. Take the question, somebody says, Africa. Go to Africa. Africa. What is Africa? I doubt that most of my friends in the West are really aware just how big Africa is. It has over 1 billion people, 53 countries, and in fact you could fit all of Europe, all of the United States, all of Alaska, and all of China into Africa and still have some space left over. And all of that is somehow abstracted into Africa. I think that just shows how Eurocentric we have become. In fact, we are so Eurocentric that I remind my friends that when our notion of geography is defined by Europe, we talk about the Middle East and the Far East. In relation to whom? For an Australian, the Far East is the near north. So our notions are there. We talk of the Dark Ages. Again, in relation to whom? This was a glorious period of great Muslim civilizations spreading from Andalusia and Spain all the way to India. And at the time, they were not dark ages at all. So we feel, rightly or wrongly, a profound hostility, and this must be overcome. Muslim societies today are a stage of major contradictions and tensions. Developmental efforts are being stifled by inadequate integration, and the cultural dimensions needed in the reform process. Our societies are moving ever faster, perhaps captured best in this little image of a very traditional milk vendor in a remote village in Turkey, who has his canisters of milk and his donkey, but also has his mobile phone. So you see the penetration of new technologies, old technologies, interaction going on in all societies. We have major discontinuities. So in addition to seeking a more just global order, we must understand this perceived pervasive concern is loss of cultural identity, which actually happens in both sides. This, of course, is a cartoon about the situation in parts of Europe in dealing with immigration. We're a very tolerant society, but if you don't behave exactly like us, you can go back where your bloody well came from. So much for tolerance. Tolerance of pluralism is essential. Tolerance of pluralism is needed in this world where we are. It was already stated by my friend this great verse from the Quran, O mankind, we created you of a male and a female, and made you into nations and tribes that you may know each other. Pluralism in points of view, political perceptions, are now available not just through traditional media, but through the internet. Efforts to block out different views, whether they are motivated by a religious sense or by an atheistic sense, this is the case of China during the Cultural Revolution, where they lifted the little red book of Chairman Mao. We need to have discussion and debate. Now, Jefferson favored town hall meetings and direct democracy, as we know, and we sometimes practice this. This is inside one of our rooms in the Library of Alexandria. But complex issues require careful study. And what we need, therefore, is to get people of good faith, and goodwill, and respect, and scholarships of both sides to help us dig through the stereotypes and dig through the superficialities and get on with orderly and participatory debate. And in Egypt here, we are mobilizing Egypt's intellectuals to do this task in a number of big projects which we will talk about. And although I've used this Muslim many times to uphold human rights and freedom of expression, equality before the law, laws crafted by humans and all of that, we still have problems with the banning of books and with censorship, which in my judgment contravenes the fundamental right to express ourselves. Contrary to the stereotype that is known in many Western books, Islam was not spread by the sword. In fact, it was spread by periods of peace. When we look at the Prophet, peace be upon him, 13 years of message in Mecca, then the move to Medina, then the war with the Qurayshites continuing from that. 6 years into that war, he arrives at Hudaybiyah with 2,000 people going to pilgrimage. He had only 2,000 people with him. A peace is signed, which allows Muslims to talk freely everywhere throughout Arabia. And in 2 years, 2 years later, the peace is broken by the Qurayshites. And what happens? The Muslims now march on Mecca with 10,000. 10,000. So in 2 years, it quintupled because the message is now spread. And I remind my Muslim friends, do you think that in the last 1,400 years, there were not books attacking Islam everywhere? There was colonial powers everywhere, and despite that, Islam has spread throughout the world. It has reached from the farthest points in China and Xinjiang to the furthermost parts of Argentina and Chile in South America, from Canada in the north all the way to Australia. So let us not be afraid of opinions and ideas. We can fight ideas with ideas. Freedom of expression must be protected. And the battles must be fought again and again against those who, well-meaning or otherwise, will try to protect their views against concern. In 1926 in Egypt, we had a famous case of Taha Hussein, was accused of apostasy. And exactly 70 years later, Nasr Hamed Abu Zayd from the same university was also accused of apostasy. In the first case, it was a book, Fishari Gahili. In the second case, it was a book, Mafhum al-Nas. In the first case, the case was dismissed. 70 years later, it was upheld. Nasr Hamed Abu Zayd was not touched by the government. He was harassed in his private life till he left and went to Leiden. And he comes and gives lectures here. Occasionally nothing happens when he gives his lectures. But fundamentally, it just shows that the ideas of openness, debate, and discussion has got to be maintained, and that we have to overcome our fears and our stereotypes and move on to common understanding. Bloggers and their readers have a more shorthand and less nuanced view. I invited the whole slew of them here for Wikimania, and here's what they brought me as a t-shirt. It just summarizes their views in shorthand, censorship slash period. And in hindsight, most censorship looks foolish. Let's take the case of Michelangelo from the West. And this is, of course, part of the Sistine Chapel. Sistine Chapel is the private chapel of the Pope in Rome. And Michelangelo was called on to do this magnificent ceiling, which you see here, which was recently restored. And later on, they had problems with how to do the final front wall. And he was called on, and he painted the Last Judgment. An incredible painting that you see here. Today, almost everybody in the world, in the West, in the Christian church, and everywhere, would agree that the Sistine Chapel is one of the masterpieces of Western art, that it was something that exalts the Christian religion and the Christian faith. But it was not so at the time of Michelangelo, where his depiction of human bodies in nude form was considered pornographic. And in fact, Pope Julius II would have stood up to the critics, Pope Leo III agreed, and they actually went and repainted all these little additions to cover parts of the nude. So these are all later additions, including this bigger part here, that were made to that painting in deference to the views of the cardinals and bishops of the 15th century, beginning of the 16th century. So today, of course, we look back at this and wonder what on earth were they objecting to. But at the time, they were. And so with hindsight, we can see that freedom of expression prevails. The good works shall prevail over the bad works. And it is not by controlling ideas through force that one can win. We shall win because ideas will always defeat the sword, as Napoleon said, and ideas can only be defeated by other ideas. So obscurantist and extremist currents are standing against the tide of history, and they shall lose. Again, from the Renaissance. We think of the Renaissance as one smooth flow of progress. Michelangelo, Da Vinci, the Medici's, Florence. Yes, Florence indeed, and Michelangelo, and the House of the Medicis. But who remembers Savonarola? Savonarola was a zealot priest who controlled Florence for a number of years, threw out the Medici men, forced the Medici women to burn their finery clothes in public, from which we get the phrase, the bonfire of the vanities, confiscated their jewelry and melted it, and went around burning people at the stake because he was declaring them heretics until he himself was killed. Now, if you were living in Florence in his time, and Mr. Seraghadin came to you and said, don't worry, he is a mere blip in history, a footnote in the history books, insignificant in the march of history, you would say, are you out of your mind? He's just killed my cousin, he's torturing my brother, he's going to execute my uncle tomorrow. Yes, it is true that they sometimes, in certain periods, have an upper hand. But it is a small thing in the march of history. And so we need to think of getting beyond these things and looking at the profound aspects of civilizational interchange and open discussion and dialogue and building on education, science, and culture. Let me show you two interesting collaborations, one of which the United States is a party of, and the other is not. Force is not the answer. We have agreed to that, and we must build on this opening that has been provided by President Obama, and we hope, as Dr. Darwish said, to identify projects and programs that we can implement with it. Programs that deal with connectivity, that deal with access to knowledge, that deal with projects that we can do together. And one such beautiful project is the World Digital Library, which is a project that we are doing with the US, we, the Library of Alexandria, are doing with the US and with UNESCO. I signed a special agreement with Jim Binnington, the Library of Congress, about 4 years ago. We have been co-designers of the original work, and it is a work that brings the cultures of the world, represented by books, manuscripts, pictures, etc., each selected by the culture itself and by custodians of that culture, and presents in a digital form access to all this information everywhere in the world. Magnificent project. In fact, the governance structure is being designed next week in Washington, D.C., and I'll be there. But here is another project which the U.S. should be involved with and supporting, but it is not. It is with the UN University. And that project is quite interesting. It's called the UNL system. Some of my friends here know about that. It's a machine translation language that is designed on a universal network of language designed by the UN University. Now, the idea is that if you want to use machines to translate, say, Arabic into English, you would design a couplet between them. And then if you want Arabic into French, you have to design another couplet between Arabic and French. Now, every time you add a language, you would have to design a separate couplet. Now, the UN proposal says no. Let us build a universal network in language. And then if I want to translate from Arabic into English, I go from Arabic to UNL, and then it goes from UNL into English, and the answer from English to UNL, and then comes back into Arabic. Now, this may seem a little bit more complicated, but when you add the French, notice what happens. Now, French and English can translate for each other. And now we add German, and we add Spanish, and we add other languages, and every language then gets suddenly opened up to all the other languages. And that's particularly important for smaller languages, pluralism, diversity, cultures. Isn't it wonderful? Then that each additional language would have access to all the other languages and will bring its own contribution as well. So what we have, it's becoming a reality. All these websites have been translated using UNL system. We have done what we do. This is a big website, went this way. This is the procedure. Actually, this complex procedure that you see here is done in 0.2 of a second. All of that takes about 0.2 of a second. And here it comes back in Arabic. Now, think in terms of English and Arabic, Farsi, Urdu, Turkish, Pashtun, Bahasa, Indonesia, etc., etc. Wouldn't it be wonderful? The United States, I think, should also be involved in a project like that. So our topics for today's conference are three basic topics: education, science, and culture. If we take education, we are concerned about building and maintaining centers of excellence, a primary contribution made by some of our visitors. And we all recognize the eminence of American education. In the famous list of 500 universities, I was struck by the fact that 17 out of the 20 top universities are American. So we know the excellence of American education. We need to be involved with it, whether they are private institutions where they offer exceptional experience, or Ivy League, or public institutions like Berkeley. Let us learn together. Now, science, scientific excellence, again, the United States ranks at the very top of the pile. Science and technology is an area where the United States is at the cutting edge in almost every field. In the last 50 years, 70% of all the science Nobel laureates were awarded to US-based institution scientists. That was due to a visionary man, Vannevar Bush, who worshipped in the endless frontier, the end of the Second World War, promoted science, and a focus on science and technology in university and graduate studies, but also in how science is communicated, and how focus on science and technology at high school and college studies, and again, as I said, I think by Darwish about even in younger schools as well, in primary and middle schools, a focus on science and technology, recognizing and nurturing talent is required. In this picture, which is very nice, this is my friend Bruce Alberts, who was then the president of the Academy of Science, and that's the statue of Einstein at the Academy of Science. And this is a visiting class. And look at the ease with which they're breaking themselves out there. It's not like, oh my God, the president of the Academy, nobody talks, etc. No, no, it's feel comfortable with science. And they are in the most eminent scientific institution in the world, but it's open and accessible to people. And science, my friends, has values and emphasizes the value of truth. Any scientist that fabricates data is ostracized from all scientific communities forever. Honor, the second worst crime is to plagiarize and take somebody's work. But we also value creativity and imagination. Those who get Nobel Prizes are those who throw imagination. And science enjoys a certain constructive subversiveness, for it advances only by the destruction of the existing paradigm. If the paradigm that exists were to remain forever, there would be no scientific advance. So we expect that. And when young Einstein replaces Newton's views, we do not diminish our respect for Newton. And that requires a tolerance of engagement, for some of the views can be very weird indeed, and a method for the arbitration of disputes. These are values that not only enable scientific research to advance, it also creates a more tolerant, more humane society, and they are forged by student practice and teacher example. The first people who did this were largely the Greeks, and then the ancient library of Alexandria, the Hellenistic period, and then the Muslims, who throughout the Middle Ages lifted the torch of rationality and science. Listen to Ibn al-Haytham challenging the accepted views. For he who searches for truth follows argument and evidence, not the statement by an individual. He should set himself up as an opponent to all he looks at. Or on accepting the contrarian view, listen to this statement by Ibn Nafis, the great medical man of the 13th century. He says, when hearing something unusual, do not preemptively reject it, for that would be folly. The Arabic word is taish. Indeed, horrible things may be true, and familiar and basic things may prove to be lies. Truth is truth unto itself, not because many people say it is. That openness to the contrarian view, that openness to the unexpected, that is what allowed science and the Muslim world to go. So let's create the collaborations and the centers of excellence where science can fulfill its promise to feed the hungry, to heal the sick, to protect the environment, to promote the dignity of work, and to create space for the joy of self-expression. And self-expression, of course, brings us to culture, music, the arts, the new media, cooperation, collaboration, exchange, mutual learning, all of that is needed. But we also need to address the problems of publishing in a digital age, prizes, literary exchanges, poetry meetings. All of that is part of getting to know each other in a non-threatening and constructive way. Literature and poetry should have private place in our culture, in the Arab culture for sure, and we hope that we can have exchanges in that. But dealing with multiculturalism, which Europe is struggling with today, requires an understanding of diversity and the expressions of that diversity as opposed to the homogenization of a melting pot approach. And this requires that we understand how to deal with it. The Swiss case, notwithstanding their recent ban on minarets, the Swiss case, actually this particular mosque, and I have to say this because my friend Mustafa Sherif is here, this is the Sherif Edin White Mosque in Bosnia. It's a beautiful, award-winning piece of architecture, but that's another story. And the Swiss case, notwithstanding that, really have respected the cantonal differences in Switzerland to an enormous degree, and they live in peace and progress because they recognize these differences in language, in religion, in either form of government that exists. America has a slightly different view. Of course, approaching the Statue of Liberty near Ellis Island, it said on it, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Well, that's not quite what's happening right now in some places. But anyway, That was there, the spirit was there. So pluralism and openness enrich cultures. Let me give you a visual example. Western art started by a transformation in the beginning of the 20th century that was to engulf world art. Picasso, Braque, and others were the artisans of that revolution. They did it because they opened up to African art, which was different from Western art. And so, this is Picasso's bust of a woman, inspired by that Guinean Nimba mask. He could see a Gribo mask here and use it to generate a guitar because he was interested in shape. So he was not interested in the anthropological study of what that mask meant. But he was not alone. This is a portrait of Madame Matisse on the right, and Matisse was inspired by the Shira Kunta mask that you see here. Emil Nolder sought inspiration for the Brazilian heads that he found, and Max Ernst in his bird sculpture was inspired by that Burger mask from Burkina Faso. Barnoff Rosinet was inspired by that mask from Guinea. And the famous Demoiselle d'Avignon of 1907, a turning point in the history of art because it removed the presentation of art in depth. Look at the head of this one and the Kitumbi mask from Congo, even though there's a question about how close that particular was. What it did is that it enabled them also to see their own history with different eyes. So this is Courbet's painting, which Picasso, you have to look carefully at the arm and the head here, transformed into geometries, which you can see in this arm and head here. And that allowed them to find a totally new way to express something that was strictly Western. In this case, during the Spanish Civil War, when the first time a village was bombed from the sky, and Guernica, Picasso created this masterpiece, which is now found in a special museum for it. And its images drew not just from African art, but also from Western art. This is Eisenstein's Potemkin next to it. So let's ensure that openness and pluralism prevail in our societies. And that's why our program is dedicated to dialogue, understanding, and collaboration in education, science, and culture. There were with four cross-cutting themes: media, ICT, youth, and gender. We're focusing on special groups, such as women and youth, and journalists in particular, because they, after all, relay the messages to the public at large. They play a fundamental role, not just on the political scene, which people know about, but spreading perceptions and understanding of what is being done, especially science journalists. Youth is not only the future, they are the present. And women's role is changing in every society, and we must recognize it. So the structure we have is education, science, and culture with four cross-cutting themes. That creates a structure with 12 cells. And what we hope, therefore, is we will start with three plenary panels, one panel for each of the three main themes, and then we will go ahead with each topic after being treated in a plenary panel discussions. We'll have four breakout sessions discussing the sub-themes, from which each one of which we should bring projects for. We must elaborate projects in all of that. So that's the intention. And so if you take a cell like ICT and science, we could have courses like, or projects like a super course for science, for example. Or let's take this one, we're reissuing the classics for the old and exhibitions, 1001 inventions of Muslims, and reissuing the classics new. What is meant here is that we are in the library of Alexandria, they are reissuing the classics of medieval science by Muslims in a more accessible fashion. That's a long-term project. It's okay, it'll take 10, 15 years. We're talking about centuries anyway. We recognize the magnificent exhibition that was done in London and that needs to travel around the world. And we are reissuing the modern classics. And I have a number of people here who are participating in that project. And I was very happy to see that yesterday night, the first six books came on. These are important books that show the humanistic tradition of Islam and Islamic thinking in the last two centuries, reissued with modern introductions by modern scholars. So we'll continue on that and see what we can do. On science, well, we said we would look at Super Course and the Encyclopedia of Science. The Super Course is basically a series of lectures, PowerPoint lectures like the one I'm giving, that involves 60,000 teachers who use them as they see fit to reach a million students in 175 countries, and we have over 90 million hits a year on those websites. Now with Vin Cerf, father of the internet, Ron Laporte and Gil Omen, we are working on expanding that from epidemiology, which is that first proof of concept, to the rest of health, environment, agriculture, and parts of the GA. Now, the Encyclopedia of Life is a project we're doing with the Smithsonian, and we recognize 1.9 million species. Each species will have a page, and behind that, we have 300 to 600 million pages of biodiversity literature which can be digitized. And all of that will be put on a website, and we are now working with them on Arabizing that to contribute to the Arabic contribution, as well as Arabize some of the material. These are the entry page, and these are the individual species pages. On culture, well, there's a lot of things that can be said on culture, but I am working with Martin Scorsese and New York University to try to get some young Egyptian artists to go and learn the trade at the Tisch School in New York. But we need to address TV, film, FM, music, artworks, museums, libraries, theater, film. And incidentally, we will have a number of cultural activities during this program. In the evening, there'll be music. Tomorrow, there's a cultural evening at the fort. And there'll be a visit to our Muslim visitors from all over the world to Morsi Abul Abbas on Friday, where His Excellency, the Mufti of Egypt, will be presiding with the sermon. Plus, we have two additional plenaries. One is about youth-led development, and the other is about interfaith dialogue. Youth-led development, we need to recognize that in science, youth has led the way. Einstein was 26 when he revolutionized the world, and Newton was under 30 when he revolutionized optics, discovered gravity, and calculus. Heisenberg was 26 when he discovered the uncertainty principle. Jim Watson was 25 when he discovered the structure of DNA. Alan Turing invented computing when he was 22, and Claude Shannon wrote his master thesis on logic gates when he was 22 at MIT. And if you move from research to the real world, hey, look at all these guys. They're extremely young. Bill Gates, Pierre Amidyar, Jimmy Wales, Michael Dell, Steve Jobs, all of these people, they reinvented the way the world works, and they were all in their 20s, in the early 30s when they did that. So the technology that will help connect young people everywhere, creating networks, expanding our brain's reach, it opens the path to a future that could be great. But for that, we have to go back to what Dr. Ahmed Darwish mentioned, the core values that we share. Because unfortunately, explosions of intolerant anger and extremists who spread the gospel of hate create terrible, terrible situations where Muslims are the biggest victims. For Muslims, in fact, are being killed by Muslims more so than anywhere else in the world. And Europe and the West have known their own dark history of the Inquisition. Pascal said that men never do evil so completely as when they do it from religious conviction. What we need, therefore, is to go back to the core values of tolerance, openness, and recognize, let there be no compulsion in religion, la ikrah, the truth stands out clear from error, and when addressed by the ignorant, say peace. That is important things to remember. Learning to live together is important, and thus this interfaith dialogue we hope will contribute to that as well. And so, my friends, as we start in this rich program, I say to each of us, let us dare to dream and dare to be bold. We can do things differently, and we can succeed. And I will give you two closing examples. The first of these is Antarctica, where when it was first discovered, Antarctica, people immediately said, bring in the bulldozers, industry, oil, minerals, money, military bases. And some people, including my late friend Jacques Cousteau, said no. Let us keep the pristine wilderness for science and for future generations. And people said, are you out of your mind? You want the whole continent turned over to the penguins? And he said, yes. And guess what? The Antarctica Agreement was made. And there was no deep sea drilling there. There was no mineral mining. There was there's no military bases brought into Antarctica. Can happen. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has, said Margaret Mead. For those of us who have lived and learned and studied in the United States, we remember 1963, a great dreamer, a great man, Martin Luther King, standing in Washington, D.C., saying, I have a dream. I have a dream that my children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. And dreams can be realized. 45 years to the day, Barack Obama stood and accepted the Democratic nomination for president. Martin Luther King did not live to see his dream implemented, but it was. Gandhi barely saw the beginnings of what would happen to India, rising today as a great power. President Obama not only has stretched out his hand, he's asked for the audacity of hope. And I know that there are strong forces promoting hatred and fear, both in the West. In the West, there are lots of forces promoting hatred and fear, but also in the East. But we can defeat the forces of hate and confrontation and build, through education, science, and culture, better understanding for our future. We can improve our societies and the world we live in. And working all together, there is so much we can do for a whole generation and for the whole world. And so, let us advance. And if sometimes it seems that this group of us here seems small, and that the opposition looks fierce, I tell you, we will surprise them. Thank you very much.